to move on to item 3 on the agenda, which is the minutes of the meeting held on the 16th of September. And if you've had a chance to look at them, can those who were present at that meeting assure me that they are an accurate record of that meeting? Item 4 on the agenda is the financial monitoring report for the last quarter, quarter two. And I think we've got Jason is going to talk us through it, and we've got some help from Matthew Cox, yes, and not from Alexandra Davidson, but somebody who's masquerading as Alexandra Davidson. His name I'm afraid I don't know. You, Matthew?
Charles, there's a question that Margaret's going to talk us through and
okay, you want to toss a coin? Any
questions?
Okay, thank you. Chair, same offer as last quarter, would you like me to walk you through the reports? Or,
yeah, okay. And members will have read it, I'm sure.
That's absolutely fine, thank you. Okay, so this is the financial position of the department as of the end of quarter two. And the forecast position presented is an adverse movement of £965,000 from the previously reported balance position. The main cause of that adverse variance is an increase in demand for services, predominantly in the care homes. So there has been a significant increase in demand for care at home and also supported living services, where there have been increases of 6% and 8% respectively. By comparison, demand for more traditional residential nursing care services has only increased by 1% over the same period. In the achievement of that forecast £965,000 adverse position, it is reliant upon the delivery of a number of in-year efficiency plans, which are handed as appendix 2 to this report, and the list in table 3.1.6. The table underneath in 3.1.8 graphs that increase in demand. For those that don't have a version colour, the decreasing line at the top represents residential nursing care, so we can see the overall decrease in demand for those services over the past 3 years, which coincides with the increase in demand for both supported living services and ancillary care services, which are the second and third lines in that. Section 3 of this report deals with the position of the pooled fund between World Council and World CCG. There is a total pool of over £140 million, and that is forecast to be in surplus by £34,000 a year end. The breakdown of that is included in the table underneath in 3.2.1. And there are a combined total, there were a combined total known budget challenges of £4.5 million facing the pool in 2019-20. Mostly relating to pre-agreed savings targets and demographic growth across the learning disabilities and mental health services across the adult care and health and world CCG areas. Work is going on to quantify the mitigation identified against those pressures. And as we say, on 3.2.3, the financial challenges experienced by the CCG and World Council will continue throughout 2019-20 despite integration. Key point to note in regards to the pool funders in 3.2.4, which is that the ring fence public health grant continues to forecast the budget, and that £6.8 million of the public health grant is contained within the Medicare care fund line in the table above. Section 3.3 deals with the savings of the department. So at the start of the year, there were approved savings identified of £8.6 million, of which £2.4 million are reported as being delivered at the end of quarter two, and that leaves a total of 5.3 still to be delivered by the end of the year. That there is a breakdown of that 8.6 million just underneath, and again, that's contained within the appendix 2 to this report. Section 3.4 deals with the performance of the capital budget of quarter two, so we can see that there was a total capital strategy for the department of £6.7 million. Start of the year, £2.1 million of which is related to our care and health, and there's been an actual spend of just over £1 million to date against that. the progress on significant schemes within that capital scheme in 3.4.3, which is the alcohol treatment scheme, the LD extra care housing scheme, and the non-LD extra care housing schemes as well, with explanations there for those variances. That comprises the entirety of the main body of the report, so there's some dependencies there. So, if there's any questions.
Chair, just wondering why there's an increase in demand for services, and if anyone can elaborate on.
Thank you. Year on year, we're seeing an increase in services. It's generally related to the older population and the demographic growth, but we are also seeing increases in complexity of our population. Needs and learning disability, and of course mental health needs, because for example a lot of the support of living placements are also for mental health supporters as well as learning disability support. So the growth in demand is largely coming from demographic growth, people living longer, living with long-term conditions, and also the survival rate and complexity of younger working age adults. A further issue that we are seeing each year, particularly this year, is an increase in the volume of hospital discharges and the focus on reducing length of stay, which is the right thing for older people, so that people aren't deconditioned within hospital and they get the best chance of returning home. But it does mean the volume and speed of discharges is an issue, so we have seen a significant growth in the demand for domiciliary care in people's homes particularly, and I think
So work is ongoing to quantify the mitigation that's identified, and that does sound somewhat vague, I have to say. More cost-effective commissioning, I'd like some information about what that means. That sounds very nice, but in practice, what does that actually mean? And I'm always concerned about comments like maximising independence and well-being. We need to be extremely careful. It just doesn't mean reducing service levels. Alan's assurances that is not what we mean by maximising independence. I'd like to know exactly what we do mean. My other question is around the identified savings of the 5.2 million. How certain is that, given that at the end of Q2 we've only delivered 2.3? What's our level of confidence that we're going to actually deliver the rest of it by the end of this year?
I'm going to say that Cllr Nolan's included something that I was going to ask about. Part of my questioning was about how realistic are these savings, and particularly around the joint funding cases that are over a year old, because they're over a year old for a reason, and the full recovery of third party top ups. How realistic are they as part of your savings plan?
Thank you. Jack, a number of questions there. First of all, I'd like to offer reassurance about maximising independence and well-being. There's always a balance between supporting people to live independently as they can, albeit they've got complex needs often and need a lot of support. What we are focusing on is the optimal levels of support for people, so that we are using assisted technology and people in the right homes with the right core support or background support, and the one-to-one support that people require, or support during the night time of one-to-one from a staff member, is proportionate to their needs. So it's always a fine balance, but we really are optimising independence and well-being for people. It's not about cutting people's services, it's about achieving the right level of support in the environment that they're in. In relation to the in-year corrective action, the joint funded cases line, which I think is in 3.116, Chair, which is the 600,000, that's in relation to identification of the accounting process this year, that we haven't actually collected that joint funded income. So these are existing joint funded cases where the CCG are aware of these cases. It's not new joint funded decisions, it's about collection of the funding from the CCG, which we haven't previously accounted for in quarter one. Recovery of the third-party top-ups, which is just under 400k, again, is about our identification of that in our accounting reporting, and it's about making sure that we capture and include the third-party top-up collections that we've got in place already. So these are arrangements where people have exercised the choice of accommodation, they've chosen particular care homes that are more expensive than the usual rate that the household pays, and a third party family member, for example, has agreed to pay the difference in order that they can exercise that choice. So this is making sure that we account that there are projected costs for the collection of those third party top ups where we haven't previously shown that separately.
If you don't mind, I've got another question I'd like to ask if everybody else is okay. Okay, I think we're finished. It's in relation to, further on, when you're looking at the report on winter pressure and the needs of the Better Care Fund, there's a reference to savings being achieved by reducing by 15 the number of long stay beds. In section 3.1.4 of this report, you talk about increasing demand for home care services. Now, my assumption would be that if you're reducing the demand for long stay beds, you increase the demand further for home care. And we did hear, it must have been at the Health and Care Panel, we did that there is increasing problems in
observed a 17% growth in activity since April this year. We've been very hard with providers. Since the middle of August, we have seen a slight deterioration in the waiting list for people. Broadly speaking, the majority of that pressure is in our reablement services, in part due to the point that Jason made a few minutes ago with regards trying to reduce long length of stay in the acute setting. So we're seeing an increase day on day. So for an example, we're averaging now about 30 to 35 complex discharges a day. And this time last year, it would have been around 20 to 25. So you can see the extra volume, and we have grown the market. So we're working very hard with providers. We absolutely, it's our priority to continue to prioritise at-home support, to maximise independence, to keep people independent and at home, and that's where our priority is. As part of that, your comment around the bed base, our intermediate bed base commission, which I will touch on later, the comment around reduction of 15 beds is not a real term reduction. It is actually about improving our approach, optimising our resources and the model that we have by tightening up our grip and the 7-day input that we give to people who are in those short-term intermediate assessment beds. And by improving our performance, it releases the equivalent of about 15 beds, or would provide an additional 15 beds being commissioned. So it's not that we're taking them away, it's actually about improving performance.
Sorry, Jackie, that wasn't really the gist of my question. The gist of my question was, if there is a reduction in the availability or the need for long stay beds, then there's going to be a commensurate increase in the home care. And what we've heard lately is that there is a problem in supplying that home care. And that was the point I was making, really.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a very, very live situation, and we're keeping a close eye on that. So we do have a mixture of bed-based intermediate assessment, but also that home-based service. We have a number of things that we're doing to try and increase the capacity in the market.
I'm just wondering, how does the demographic growth on Wirral discussion...
Sorry, apologies.
Yeah, how does the demographic growth pressures on the Wirral stack up with the national average?
I haven't got the exact figures in front of me, but we are above the national average in terms of frail older people. The over 85 population can happily just check the actual figures and circulate those later tomorrow, if that's okay.
Okay, are we done with that one? Can we say thank you very much? Reporters for noting. Okay. We'll move on to item 5 on the agenda, which is update on the Cottier Cancer Centre by Dr. Liz Bishop, who is the Chief Executive of the Cottier Cancer Centre. Nice to have you here. Sorry, I've got the microphone. I'm excited to have you here, Dr. Bishop. I would like to talk through the report.
Yes, thank you for inviting me here today to provide an update on the Clatterbridge Cancer Centre. You will see from the report this has been a long journey to get to this point. So in 2008 there was a clinically led piece of work that recommended that an additional site be developed in Liverpool, co-located with the acute hospital and the university. To improve patient pathways, particularly those patients that are the most critically unwell. As you will see from the paper, we intend to keep the Wirral site open and similar to our Aintree site in North Mersey. And the new site will give us additional capacity to cope with the growth in cancer cancer care that is required for this region. It's a very positive thing for the region. It will enable us to avoid transfer of patients to another site when they require critical care and services, and it will help us improve our access to research for patients with cancer, thereby facilitating number one, access to trials, but actually this is important for us as a specialist centre and to provide equity of access to trials for the patients in this region. You will see that we have a multi-site model. We've given some slides
sites that we've covered across the 2.4 million population. We've given you some activity figures here and some timelines for handover of the new site. It'll be around February, March time. We're at that critical point of finishing the build with a plan to open for our patients mid-May 2020. And that gives us time to commission the building and to get the patient ready. And for those of you who have not seen it, there's some pictures of the new build there. So it's really just to update this committee. Happy to take any questions, but this is all about improving patient care and pathways for patients in the region.
Well, thank you very much for that, Dr. Bishop. And I think there will be some questions that I'd like to ask some questions, because myself and Councillor Wendy Cummins were on the scrutiny committee across the region when this was first put forward as a proposal. And I think we completely accepted the clinical case to relocate closer to an acute hospital was made. And our concern at that time was the facilities that would be left available for Wirral residents at Clatterbridge. And what we were told was that it would be an enhanced service at Wirral. And I'd like to hear a little bit more detail about how what is going to be there will be enhanced. And if it's possible, and I don't know whether it is, if you could give me some idea of the proportion of rural residents who will have to travel to Liverpool to be treated, and those that can be treated on the Clatterbridge site. That's, and then I'll take questions.
So if I just answer the last bit first. So the majority of patients get most of their care, oncology care, as outpatients, ambulatory care. I don't have a specific number, but it's only a few patients that require inpatient care. So majority of Wirral patients will have their care in the Wirral. So radiotherapy, chemotherapy, outpatient clinics, imaging and diagnostics will all continue on the Wirral site. With regards to the further developments on the Wirral site, the plan is to obviously get through this stage to open the new site, and we are just commissioning a piece of work as to what we need to do to refresh the Wirral site, because the estate is good, the services are good, but we need to do a refresh of that site.
I'm conscious that other people will want to ask questions as well. So from what you're saying, your plan is to enhance the Clatterbridge site, but you're not sure how that's going to take place.
No, we're just starting a piece of work now, so that after the move of the inpatient services to Liverpool in May, we will undertake, we're undertaking the design work between now and then. And then we will start that work on the Wirral site. So towards the end of next year.
Towards the end of next year, you start the redesign.
No, we'll do the design piece between now and the summer, but we hope to start that work.
Can I ask then that those redesigns are brought to this committee?
We'd be happy to.
Because that will be obviously the focus of our attention.
Yes.
And maybe some
of it. We'd be more than happy to share those design changes.
Councillor Gilchrist.
I think you recall being on the scrutiny committee, but I remember there were presentations to members and many questions were asked about the purpose of the move. I suppose in layman's terms, I picked up that the machinery, which I'll simplify in layman's terms, for all the work, had to be in place first and pretty well a new hospital built around it in order to be effective. But of course, the other half of the jigsaw was the need to be close to services that might be called on if patients had a number of conditions that needed the kind of treatment we would have had in the hospital. So it was convenient to be on site. Unfortunately,
So some of the mitigation and workarounds have been related to the building itself. So they have been achieved and delivered. So, for example, our building is dependent on medical gases via that route, so we've had to do a dive out there. So that work is complete. We're working very closely with the Royal and injury hospitals on just making sure that all of that work is in place, transfer samples, for example. Are slightly different because the new site, the new Royal site, isn't open. So they've been extremely helpful, very patient-centred, and we're very grateful to them, and we have all those workarounds in progress, I would say, and we still feel confident that we can open in May. Does that help?
Because of the location of Wirral, I don't have a picture of where staff and work at Clatterbridge are coming from and how relocation will affect the need for staff to access the new site and how that has been catered for in the arrangements for the new operation.
So our staff come from all over the region because they want to work in cancer, so not surprisingly they travel. We have largely given staff the choice of which site they want to work on, and that includes our peripheral sites as well on the map. And then staff that have to move, we have worked through individual travel plans with them. Again, we've worked with transport on getting our staff to work, and we have
just a couple of questions really. You're saying you've got parking arrangements. Patients that have to travel over there, you've got a shuttle bus that's going to be being used, I understand. Is that true?
So we have arrangements for parking arrangements in Liverpool as well. The car park, we have a shuttle bus from the car park to the new site. It's a short distance. Some patients will be able to walk, but others we've got a shuttle bus.
I see. I thought it was over a longer distance, but that's fine. Okay, you say that part of the benefits is for the research centre, yet the research centre is staying in Clatterbridge.
Yes,
why has that not been taken over?
So there's the big advantage is that the academics, so the cancer academics, are located and work for Liverpool University, University of Liverpool. The clinical trials unit is based in the University of Liverpool. We will literally just be across the road from the university, so that will enable what we call translational research from the bench into the bedside in the hospital. The research, it's quite complicated, the research and the research back office function, if you like, will largely be based in the Wirral. So, we'll be working across the sites.
So there's no intentions of taking the research site completely out of the Wirral?
No.
It will always be a research site.
The Wirral will remain a research centre site. And in fact, our ambition is to increase our research activity, which we've done in the last year, but we aim to grow that even more.
Just one more comment, so thanks for that. Obviously, this is a financial loss for Clatterbridge. Have we done any financial modelling around what is going to happen with the Clatterbridge side of the remainder of the cancer care?
So the way our finances are managed is that we don't separate it out by site, it's by service lines. So in terms of it's, if you were to ask me what percentage of, I wouldn't function on it that way. So
question was, obviously you're taking the inpatients to Liverpool, and obviously where patients go, funding goes, is that going to put any strain on the remainder of the cancer care within Clatterbridge?
No, I would say no, absolutely not. You know, so if a scanner needs replaced or a radiotherapy machine that needs replaced, we have a programme of replacement irrespective of site. Does that help?
Thank you, Liz.
Anybody else got a question? Thanks for that, Dr. Bish. Oh, sorry. That's very
good. Thank you, Jo. Just a question on the shuttle bus that you mentioned earlier. You say it's not that far away, 10 or possibly. That's what you said. A lot of people are going through cancer treatment have mobility problems. Is there any facility for wheelchairs on this shuttle bus?
Yes, there will be. The other point, apologies I didn't say, was we have a drop-off zone, so that if patients were working with Liverpool Council to get that drop-off zone right, so that we can drop patients with disabilities or who need help, and then the relative can go and park, and then, as I say, we have the shuttle bus arrangement as well to support others.
Okay, one more question, and just on the question of transport again, but for staff travelling from Wirral to the new site on Liverpool, obviously it's going to be difficult for them to travel, especially with the transport situation that it is at the moment. Is there any assistance that's put in place to give some sort of support to the staff? I'm thinking more so staff working shifts and coming on late at night with the transport system, if that really isn't that good, to be honest.
So there's parking. We've got an arrangement with the Royal about parking for unsocial, you know, hours. We have, as I said, every member of staff are working up their individual travel plans, and we have working through the detail. We've had discussions with staff on the staff side and had open communications with them around paying the excess travel costs, so that if someone has excess travel costs because she's no longer working with Wirral and has to go into central Liverpool, then that will be covered.
Thank you for that. It was just some clarification really about the inpatient care, because at the moment obviously Mersey Ward is very good, and people who are undergoing treatment have direct access to Mersey Ward for things like neutropenia or whatever it happens to be. And my concerns are, what are we going to do about our patients on the rural, sort of, who are unwell? Will they have to travel to Liverpool? I understand about the inpatient cancer treatment, but this is about patients who require that sort of treatment on the rural, will they have to travel to Liverpool?
Yes, so some of you may be aware that we have a known Cllr helpline, and the purpose of that helpline is your first port of call for patients to say, where do I need to come to? And sometimes patients need to be directed to the nearest accident emergency. Sometimes we can take them in, treat them and discharge them again in our clinical day unit. And sometimes patients need to be admitted. The proportion of patients that need to be admitted will have to be admitted to the Liverpool site. So that is a small number of patients, as I said, that do need to be admitted at a particular time. The rationale for the co-location is to avoid transfer in ambulance, access to what I call the other ology supports. So if they need a renal specialist or a liver specialist, they'll be able to pop across the corridor or into our building and review those patients. So it's a very good clinical model, and one that I think will be the envy of centres. It's extremely good. So I get the inconvenience, and I get that the patients have currently been here, but it's a safer, better model.
So, sorry, just to go back. So what about those patients who can go in and just be treated during the day and then come home? Will they still have to travel to the
hospital?
So you'll still have that ward facility open? That helps a little bit.
Yeah. Well, as far as possible, that's the beauty of the helpline, is we try and get the patient in the right place at the right time. It's interesting in discussions about bed pressures. We always want to avoid admission if possible and get the patient in the right place, and that's what we're trying to. It might be that they might need to see somebody special in Liverpool, but the beauty of the helpline is we can get that clinical advice to them.
Okay, thanks very much. I think we're ready to the recommendation is that we note the report book, and I also add that we have a follow-up report brought to the committee in, is it June 2020, based on the plans for Cottierbridge, but enhanced service at Cottierbridge will be.
Yeah, I can
okay.
Get it
all. Well, we'll be a bit faster if they're not quite
there.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to have that answer to the work for it.
It's nice.
Thanks very much.
Thank you very much.
Diane, you're very willing to stay, but if you find this pressing, you need to do
please. Yeah, my dogs are all over.
Could somebody ask Councillor Jordan if she'd like to come back in? Would she come back in? We'll just give her a minute to get in.
Just sent me an all out to
services, and we'll be playing a role in that.
in terms of one of the early pieces of work we've done is to bring the family safety unit and the HBA services into children's services for their operational management and the early intervention team, which is part of the Safe World Hub, so that they're now all managed through one service area.
I'm just going to go through the timeline that's on page 7. So starting really in terms of some of the work that we've already started to progress, which is around the introduction of a daily domestic abuse meeting to ensure there's multi-agency and timely response to high-risk and high-impact domestic abuse referrals, which are made both to the family service unit, family safety units and to the integrated front door. So in children's services, all the requests for services where any partner agencies, members of the public, have concerns for children, we refer them to the IFD. So we discuss in that daily meeting any of the bold referrals that are made by the police or any referrals that any partners make to the family safety units or any which come into children's services, again from any partner agency. And our reason for doing that was we would, in the IFD, we have a really quick turnover from the police referrals. Sometimes there's a 2-week delay with them going to FSU. So what we wanted to do is kind of rationalise that process so that it was much more efficient and we were risk managing more effectively on a daily basis. So that's one of the pieces of work that we've started to do already.